Welcome, 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 everybody. Welcome to the next edition of Brandversation. And today we have with us two very well-experienced professionals. Sanchayeeta Verma, who is the Senior VP of Wavemaker, and Sundar Kondur, SVP, Senior VP of the Times Group, Times of India. They are in conversation with Ravi Diabrio and myself, Larry Kali. So before I introduce them, let me share some house rules. Firstly, if you're not following us on our social media pages, we request you to do so. We are there on Facebook, Instagram, YouTube as Never Too Small to Brand. All the past episodes are available there and you can check the various platforms to see them. So coming to some rules, I request all of you to mute your mics to avoid any disturbance and interruption when the talk is going on. Just in case if you drop off in between or if there is any power outages, we request you to log on to the same Zoom call to join the webinar again. If you have any trouble logging into Zoom, remember, we are streaming on Never Too Small to Brand Facebook page, so you can go there and watch it too. So whatever questions which you have, please type the same in the chat window and we will surely see to cover most of them during the later part of the session. Just in case if your question is not answered, don't be disheartened. We request you to post the same in the coming section of our FB or YouTube feeds, and we will get the speakers to come and answer the questions there. So coming to speakers, first, Sanchayeeta Verma, Sanchi as we know her as, is the Senior VP at Wavemaker. She's been driving growth across different businesses of Groupam India and South Asia for the past 15 years. She's established the Wavemaker South India business, steering their teams to deploy award-winning industry-first practices using digital, data science, content, and trading. From 2017, she's been in charge of setting up and running Wavemaker ITC business, in charge of multiple teams across Mumbai, Bangalore, Chennai, Hyderabad, as well as Kolkata. Loaded with insights and strategies, so you can ask her a lot of questions pertaining to the same. Sundar Kondur, coming to Sundar, again, worked across various media groups and is currently the SVP of Senior Vice President of Times of India Group response team. He's held various national sales positions, sales head positions in the Hindu, Vijay Karnataka, and with the Midday too. Very seasoned advertising media professional, loves collaborating, co-creating solutions with advertisers. So you can get in touch with him for any collaborations that way. On a personal front, he loves going for long drives and he's a hardcore foodie too. So if you have any questions on that, you can ask about that too here. Okay, so welcome again. So let's start off. Over to you, Ravi.
And what we have to keep in mind is that we know that we are getting into a recessionary kind of a situation. So there is this entire discretion, there is this entire caution which consumers are showing at this point in time. So unless your category or the brand that you are operating or, you know, the product that you're selling is not absolutely relevant at this point in time, you know that people are not going to buy your product because, you know, savings, for every recession, savings go up. People cut down on all luxury items and, you know, they will make these, they will say that instead of doing, a vacation or doing some, you know, buying something which is truly luxury, let me upgrade a usual product. I was buying, a small packet of biscuit, but I'm going to buy something which is going to be more luxurious at that point in time, but it is not going to cost me money. So, these are the things that, you know, we have to kind of keep in mind. But if you're in home entertainment, for instance, that is something that is booming at this point in time. So you will have to advertise for that. What is important is that, am I keeping a war chest in place so that when things become normal, I have adequate funds. I have the wherewithal and to actually utilize the situation at that point in time. And have I done enough scenario planning right now so that I can predict what is going to be the scene 6 months hence and 12 months hence, so that I am not reacting at that point in time, but I have my game plan in place. These are some of the things that people need to do. So, you know, there were these very interesting things that Google, in fact, pulled out some of the things that people are doing right now. They looked at all the initial communication which was happening. And they said that, you know, you need to be compassionate at this point in time, because ultimately people are suffering. Whether it is people who are, you know, unwell, the number of deaths that we are seeing, the migrant labor, the entire concern, you know, whatever we are seeing with the migrant labor, and in fact, a lot other, the lowest, the bottom of the pyramid, that is something that, you know, is there on everybody's mind. So you have to be compassionate. The other thing is that, like Sundar was saying, that we haven't seen the number of jokes that we've seen right now, we've never seen. You know, I don't even want to look at jokes right now anymore. So there is a huge amount of clutter. So you have to be crisp. You have to be creative. And creative does not mean that you have to put immense amount of money. But for instance, the way Dettol with TikTok, they did the entire way of washing hand, the, you know, the what they did. Or what a Kalyan jeweler has done, where they have got so many stars to come together and shoot a film. And of course, this was very intrinsic to Kalyan, because they have used these celebrities in the past. All of it is coming together to you know, all of it is coming together to support the film industry workers, who at this point, the daily wage earners, who have a problem at this point in time. So these are some of the things that you know, we need to do. Innovation is going to be very critical.
Okay, I'll just take that question. I'm not sure you got the question, but the question was, in all of this, where does it leave brands? Brands find the media the most important component of the wheel in the whole game plan to reach out to consumers of theirs. What do they do right now? What do you think they should be doing right now?
So Sanchay gave a lot of good views on that. So I won't repeat what he's saying. So let me try and give additional points. Completely agree with what she said. Now, what is the difference between a brand and a commodity? It's because to differentiate itself from products of the same genre, right? To say that I'm different in this way. Today, demand and supply equations have taken a toll. If at all once a week or something that you step out to buy some stuff, you may not get what you want, but you will just buy whatever is available to you and just come back because you need to stock up on essentials, groceries, you know, what have you. So I think right now, brand communication to say I'm different, I'm superior, I'm whatever, is not going to work. And it's pointless and useless. That's the first one. If you want to spend money on doing only that, then I think you better save your money. However, I think people are also not, you know, people are very, very savvy. They are getting a lot of negative news. They're already in depressed, I would say depressed state, but, you know, sort of a negative thing. They're looking at people who can empathize with the entire situation, empathize with what they're going through, and being held into a house 24 hours a day is also not easy for any of us. So they're looking for a positive reinforcements. They're looking for things that brands are doing to help. See, there's some research that Harvard Business Review has done across 14 countries in the world. And what they've realized is that more than 60% of the people have responded saying, only the government trying to help us come out of this situation is not enough. We want brands and companies to do their bit. Otherwise, this is 60%, mind you, that we won't come out of this. So I think they're also looking for brands that they've been consuming for many, many years. See, you start consuming brands for many years only when you trust the brand and there is a relationship that you build with the brand. So they're looking at these people to not only give positive reinforced messages, but also do their bit. For example, look at the liquor companies. They've been repurposing by making hand sanitizers because they have alcohol as part of the raw material lying in the factory and everything is shut. So they're doing that. That's excellent work being done by them. Number two, I don't know if you know, Wildcraft is a Bangalore-based brand. They have repurposed a factory to make masks, very, very good quality masks that can, you know, go in for 30 washers and stuff like that. So these are all excellent work being done. Look at example in the, if you look at Walmart, for example, they're not putting out ads saying, come and buy from my store. That's quite obvious. But what they have done is they've done a short video where they're showing heroes. They're showing, you know, all the employees who are still going in this lockdown to go and work and still serve customers like you and me to help us to go and buy this stuff. So they made a video of all these people, you know, still sitting in the stores, doing the supply chain, are coming in trucks and still working overnight and doing stuff like that. And that message came from the CEO. Now, that is a communication from a brand, but he is not being salesy, if you know what I'm saying. He's not being salesy, but still people will remember all this. And, you know, once we are out of this COVID thing, after 30 days or 60 days or whatever the time be, people will remember that these guys were nice to us and they actually had a conscience and they did good for the overall society and humanity. And that will be remembered for sure. It will help the brand.
To interrupt you, what they also did is actually reinforcing their brand values. They're not moving far away from their brand values while doing this.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. But what is not good is to see ads like, for example, I'm against KFC, but what's not good is to see an ad of KFC which says finger licking good, you know, right now. Or Donald Trump standing with 8 people in a very, very small space and coming and telling about social distancing probably can be avoided. You know, yeah. Brands can avoid this kind of communication. Yeah.
I think everyone is so hypersensitive to everything around. It's important to be aware of it and to start putting out messages that, you know, respect sensitivity of people as well. And
absolutely. The right. Absolutely.
I will introduce a lot of other topics, but I just want to get down to one. I mean, we got a few questions from people to do with from the brand side, and a couple of them are from the real estate industry. I'm saying in real estate really, really depends on media, and they're sitting on inventory. What do you think your advice to them would be at this time?
Yeah, so I think I'll build on what Sundar talked about, right? That this is the time to be you know, compassionate and to build on the values that you have created from the past. See, the thing is that ultimately, whenever you are doing media planning for a for any product, you do the usual things, right? Which is that, you know, what are the media weights? What is the media weight that I'm going to be putting in? So how many people are reaching? What kind of you know, what investment do I need to put in? How long do I need to advertise? Which is the continuity? What is the frequency that I have to be reaching out? So those, whether this time or any other time, those basics of media planning will never change. So right. What real estate people really need to think about is, are people going to be purchasing right now? That is one thing. And I think Sundar may be able to, you know, throw some more light on this in terms of, I'm sure there are, because print is a very important medium for them. But I think just picking on this one thing of empathy. And, you know, a lot to learn from. We should all follow what Unilever is doing and a lot of the other companies are doing. See, empathy is very important right now. So, for instance, let's take a good example out here. Let's say Purvankara. They will be selling their current properties, but you know, everybody knows them. And there are a lot of properties where people stay right now. And we know that one of the biggest challenges at this point in time is that people are stuck at home, and there are a lot of challenges like getting groceries, etc., etc. Many, many challenges that people are facing. So, is there something that Purvankara can do to reach out to their existing properties and do something that is of value to the people who are staying in the property at this point in time? This means that I care. Now, if you take this care and then you create communication around it and you are able to disseminate to a lot more other people, then it is far better than trying to do lead generation exercises at this point in time, which may not get you the results, because you also know that people are scared at this point in time. Are they going to be investing in at this point in time? Do they want to keep the money safer because, you know, I may lose my job? We have a salary cut, and these are real issues which are there, which are looming in front of each of us. So what is it that, you know, you need to do at this point in time? But definitely show your consumers that by being with you, they stand to benefit. So things like these could actually be a better way of going about than you know, just pure lead generation advertising.
So that's an interesting point. So even your focus on what you're putting out there from a brand point of view is not targeted towards lead generation, but more on building your own brand and building a brand around empathy and compassion, that you care for your consumers. So Sundar, anything to add, Sundar?
Yeah, absolutely. I completely agree. See, the real estate industry, anyway, let me just take it from the brand. See, people, end of the day, like it or not, still look at home buying not as a investment. For people like you and me, we look at it as a sense of security. And I think right now, people's security has been shattered with what's happening around us. It may be not our problem, but the nation's problem or the epidemic is becoming everybody's problem. So I think some set of people will still say, let me just go back and have a security, because end of the day, today, if I'm being locked down, bottom for me is I have a house, I'm being inside, at least I'm safe. So I think some people will migrate towards wanting to own a house. Some people will say, like Sanchayeeta was saying, do I have a job? Am I capable of paying my EMI? Am I liquid enough? So yeah, that time will tell as to how are we going to go. But you know, the industry, for the fact that they have huge amount of laborers, okay, at different sites working. Now, I know that they have housed them in the same places. They're providing them food on a daily basis. And so is Prestige. They're doing that as well. I'm sure a lot of people are doing. I'm aware of three, four of them who are doing this. So it, obviously, those laborers will remember this. They'll remember the empathy towards them, that the company is taking care of them. Guess what? Once this lockdown gets over, they'll be the first to start off because they have a labor force that will help them to rebuild. You know, some people have lost their labor forces to different villages and stuff who have migrated. They probably will take a longer time to recoup. But coming back to customers like us, you know, in our paper, where we have given a lot of social messaging, companies who believe in it have come as partnered with us. And are, you know, saying you have all the time in the world now, you're at home, at leisure, whenever you have the time, come take a look at my mock-up apartment or at my site, use the QR code or just come to my website. And it's not being hard sold, it is being given as a very, very gentle, subtle message. And we just took a feedback from a couple of these builders and they're saying we're very happy. Because we have got a lot of people to, we're not measuring the number of site visits and stuff like that, but at least they are communicating and people are, you know, coming and checking out their different properties and stuff like that. So it's a little positive.
Okay, so, shall I pick up questions?
Yeah, just one more question before we move on, because it's interesting. Is there scope for innovation today? I mean, both the points that you both made, there's a whole delivery system that's moving very efficiently today, even more efficiently than ever, perhaps, with the Dunzos and the Swiggies and whatnot. Even the Domino's is moving to a delivery system and utilizing it to help other brands. You think there's a scope for changing the way we look at media? There is all these delivery systems actually connecting with them. Jump on the bandwagon to help use them to push our messages out. There's also a lot of new interesting technology, AR, VR. You have a point of view on that?
Yes. So one of the things is that brands are trying to figure out how to meet the online population faster. So I think what we will see from this whole thing is that how people have quickly jumped onto the become online ready now. So, for instance, in fact, the very fact that Amazon and Flipkart, and particularly Flipkart, moved completely into delivery of grocery itself shows how they have made the shift. And a lot of other brands made the shift to them. ITC, you know, doing the tie-up with Zomato is another example. The whole thing on AR and VR is also that because of this whole thing of social distancing and the fact that, you know, this is going to be there to stay for some time, there are different forms of communication where physical touch is not required. So going forward, even things like sales training, etc., there are a lot of other applications that will come in and can be utilized at this point in time. So definitely this, innovation in communication. The other thing that we're talking about is innovation in distribution. Actually, that's the other thing that we are seeing, and innovation in consumer outreach. umbrella branding of a company and, you know, showing that the company cares is very important. If you take learning from what happened during the last, you know, one of the recessions, which is the dot-com bubble, a lot of companies, Google, in fact, was born out of that recession. So I am sure we will be seeing a lot of the startups, etc., who are there in Bangalore, for instance. There could be opportunities which are available for them, and they have to be able to find the right connect to at this point in time.
Awesome. Sundar?
Yeah, absolutely. See, for example, a lot of realization comes and hits you when you're dealing with this on a daily basis. So for example, I'm sure companies will be kicking themselves by saying, why didn't they provide laptops to everybody in the organization? Because now they're seeing, depending on the kind of company, 10, 20, 30% of the workforce is sitting at home, but unable to get work out of them because they don't have laptops. The company didn't give them laptops. Look at it from a household point of view. A lot of people will be kicking themselves by saying, why didn't you get that dishwasher? Or why didn't you get that automated device that will help me do my housework properly? So you will see in the next 2-3 months' time, whenever things open up, that demand for these things are going to just skyrocket. Absolutely skyrocket, because you know, human beings are people who, having gone through the pain, will say, let me just go and buy it, let me find the money for buying a dishwasher or a laptop, doesn't matter, you know, because they've gone through that pain for 21 days or looks like it won't be longer, I don't know, but you know, those things will absolutely pick up stuff. But coming back to something else, another question which you didn't ask, but I'm just preempting that. What will happen to people watching movies? If people are what used to watching television at home, OTT, you know, will I ever go back to a PVR? Will I ever go back to an Inox and stuff like that? My personal view is that human beings are social animals. You know, I'm just telling you my prediction. The minute they open up the lockdown, the minute they open the bars and the restaurant, for the first 1 week, there's going to be chaos. People are just going to be crowding in all these places and doing the stuff, even though they know the dangers. But I think people just need to go out there, see people. That's how we are, social beings. So some of the things that you see now, a couple of things may just remain. For example, a work from home may not be a permanent thing, but maybe a couple of days work from home may come back to reality. Okay, so some of the learnings that has happened, now people will learn how to sell over a call. People will learn how to sell over a, through a Hangout or, you know, a Zoom. So I think people are reskilling and people are learning new things, which is, I think, good for us. Okay, so maybe a few good things will come out of it. But I want to see people, things go back. I got used to, cleaning and washing things in my house, and I don't want maid anymore. I don't think anybody's going to say that. So certain things, I think, will come back to normal. But we will learn from this as to what are the different things that we can do efficiently, things that we can do differently. Out of every big problem in this world has come innovation, has come a new way and more efficient way of working. Look at all the big things that have happened and all the wars. Well, see what happened to Japan after the bombing. They came out much stronger. You know, look at any of the big things that have happened in the world, it's always made people more resilient. Human beings are social in nature and they are extremely resilient.
Probably we'll find Western brands distancing the table, the space between the tables, and still.
So if I was in PVR or Inox, I would already in the downtime try and make the seats, not so close. I'll be getting ready for it right away.
Take one seats off in between?
I don't know. I don't even airlines, buses, I don't know.
Correct.
Okay, so on a lighter note, what Sundar was saying, this is Ramesh here.
Ramesh, I know some three or four people. A little later, Ramesh?
Sorry, yeah.
Yeah, so when the Q&A time starts, you can come. So there are some questions which is coming into the chat window. So one of them, is typically there are two extremes. One is from a training industry and second is from a travel and tourism industry. Now I see training booming while travel and tourism really requires innovation to kick in. Probably it's the time of days for all you know, right? So what's your take for these two industries in terms of what the future is going to be like, how they should be positioning themselves from a perspective of reaching out to their audiences and stuff like that? What's your point of view on these two?
So there are some really good learnings that we already have that the travel and tourism industry have done. And obviously, they're the ones who've been hit really badly. But for instance, there is IXCGO and Indigo and British Airways. I think there's some noise coming. So what they have done is they have done this whole thing of free cancellations and flexible bookings, right? So understanding at this point in time, there are a lot of things that people cannot do because obviously you cannot travel. But is there a way of keeping people engaged, you know? So that when this thing opens up, first thing, the very fact that they have given free cancellations. In fact, and I can empathize totally because actually I and my husband had gone to New Zealand just before the embargo started. So we went in the beginning of just on the March 1st and we came in on 12th March. And 13th March is when the lockdowns, etc. happened. So when we went, COVID was just something which was, you know, in China and in some parts of the world. And then in those 2 weeks, everything changed. And the whole problem was that we had booked this months in advance and we had not canceled the tickets. So, you know, if we could not cancel, then we would have lost a lot of money. So these are some of the things. So actually what the travel and tourism industry needs to do is that they need to actually go back to the usual basics, which is consumer behavior. What are the barriers right now? What are the opportunities? What are the triggers right now? And therefore, can I look at this time to share with them? You know, I can't step out of my home, but virtually can I discover a place? You know, and is there something that I can plan for a holiday in the future, but I can also keep it flexible so that, you know, I do not lose time? Typically, when you're going to a place, you do a lot of research, and that research takes about, sometimes it even takes 6 months to a year. How can they look at this time for that pre? So if you look at consumer journey, typically we say consumer journeys, right? Which is where there is a consideration phase and then there is an action phase. So can I now look at the earlier part of the consumer journey, which is when people are doing the planning, so that by the time the action comes into place, you know, they will be able to convert those people into actual purchases for themselves. So this, Sundar may want to add for, onto this.
Yeah. So let me break that into two parts. One is travel, one is tourism. Travel is official, which is business travel. Another one is leisure travel, right? So I think business travel is obviously need-based. And I think most of that is being sorted out by, mediums like what we're using right now, WebEx and so on and so forth. And that will continue to happen, I feel, for a long time. Because even in the Lehman Brothers crash happened for about 6 months, a lot of travel companies gave advisory for two reasons. One is safety. Second is to save money. And I think that is true of most corporates right now. I think they're in a cost control mode. So business travel, I think, is not going to happen in a hurry unless it's really important. Personal travel, again, I think will happen, need-based. If somebody's stuck somewhere because of lockdown, they have to come back home, or, you know, if there's a misfortune in the family or a very important wedding that I can't miss, will happen. But that, I think, in my opinion, will happen domestic. International travel, I think, is going to take quite some time to come back to normalcy. One is the fear of what's going to happen. The second, the fear of what happens if you get stuck there and not able to come back, which a lot of people are still stuck, in foreign countries. So that's on travel. So look at tourism. Again, tourism is purely, I won't call it business, I would call it leisure. I think it's not going to bounce back in a hurry. I think it's going to take a long time because it is not what you call an essential thing. It is more of a luxury. It's more of a, you know, I need to pamper myself. I need to sort of, it's in that space. And I think people will go back and see, is it safe to travel? A, B, do you have extra monies now that I can, probably spend a lakh or a couple of lakhs to do this kind of stuff? So those are the questions that people start asking. The third question, in my opinion, people will ask is, do I want to go back and stay in a hotel, you know, or a resort that's got 500 people? And do I want a mix of people because it'll have all kinds of people there and I don't know whether I'm safe there? So I don't know whether they'll start choosing things like Airbnb, smaller formats, you know, which is a little bit more safer for them. Or I don't know if maybe resorts and five-star hotels can say, we're not going full. We'll ensure that we don't have more than 30-40% occupancy for your own safety. So, you know, please come over. I don't know. But I think whatever they do in the short term, I don't think they're going to get any benefits. But when things open up, they have to be very careful in how they communicate and how they take this forward. Because one is fear, second is money. These two are big factors that are going to influence this industry.
Okay, so...
In fact, just one interesting example of how to, like Sundar said, during this time, there will be no sales. And obviously for people in the travel and tourism business, that is going to be it's going to be killing, right? But how to go about that time? That is where, you know, looking at alternate routes of businesses, taking a leaf out of alcohol guys making sanitizers. And you know, Oyo Rooms, for instance, has come up with this whole work. You almost have seen the whole thing of work from home, right? So that's a great way of, you know, knowing that I do not have any, you know, I have extra capacity, but how can I use it in a different way, which is going to be useful for people? So thinking out of the box to utilize their current inventory is something that they will have to think of.
Okay, so before I ask the next question, there is some disturbance coming either with one of your mics. We'll just make sure that the mic is not rubbing against your shawl or t-shirt, Sundar and Sanchi. So just be aware of it. There are some messages coming on that particular front. So we're going to the next question. We're obviously seeing a spike in viewership of OTT because people are stuck at home and they are all tuned in on OTT platforms. There's no advertising options on OTT platforms. Do you think, is this going to start, are we going to see a paradigm shift in terms of choosing the media? Is print going to lose traction from a small business perspective? What would be the order of the day for them to choose the relevant mediums? Or what are the relevant mediums for them?
Yeah, so in the short term, let me just take the newspaper question first. So obviously the short term, advertising is not happening much, except for essentials and government messaging. That will pick up once things come back to normal. In OTT, so yeah. See, also because what do brands communicate? My original point that I had made earlier, what do brands communicate if they want to advertise? It's very difficult to communicate anything right now. Okay, so I think it will take some time for things to go back to what we call pre-March before we march ahead in that sense. But if you look at OTT, there is no opportunity to advertise, just consuming content. But so that, unless of course Sanchi has got a different way of innovatively trying to put some ads into OTT. But I feel that, you know, we have already reached 60-80% distribution strength in most of the cities that we operate in. I see advertising coming back shortly.
Sanchi?
Yeah. So, okay, so you know what? This whole thing of not being able to advertise and or advertising free content is something that we have to grow up to sooner or later. And I think the whole OTT, so what I was seeing was in terms of the numbers, so there are about 51%, so of the entire OTT base, the reach was going to about, we know 20% cord cutters exist. That number, I think, has gone up to somewhere around 40%. I may not be very sure. But of that, you find that the guys who have OTT, 51% of them have taken paid subscription. They're taking premium subscription, which means it is the ad-free subscription that they are taking. So this reality that someday there will be no advertising within the content is something that we have been speaking for very long. So how do you go around it? Okay. that's something that we need to figure. So one of the ways of doing it is, of course, content placement that we do, but that has a long lead time because obviously you have to get into the production cycle, which takes long. The other way of doing it is where you start creating partnerships with the OTTs, right? So for instance, if there is a joint initiative that you're doing with the Hotstar, for instance, or with the Z5, for instance, then you are able to run, firstly, pure advertising free is there primarily on Amazon Prime and Netflix, but the other guys are open to a lot of partnerships and innovations. So, and even with the Netflix, etc., there are ways that you can do these partnerships, right? So therefore you create content which either runs on the OTT as a promotion that they are running for themselves, or, you know, in different ways it can run as content on the platform itself. So that's the way that we will have to see how to work around it. The other thing is, for instance, on a lot of these OTTs, there are chat windows, right? So for instance, I think Z5 had done this where for apparel, for instance, the product that you're seeing inside the content, you can actually click on a button and then you can buy that product, right? So there are, because of technology, there are a lot of options which are available by which you can do the advertising. So that's something that we should definitely explore because A, it is also, you can measure it, right? So you do the activity and you can start from the click to the final purchase. There are ways in which you can actually, figure out whether that is working for you or not. The other thing is that we know that Swiggy, Zomato, etc. were doing a lot of campaigns where you could ride with them. So I don't, or even a Flipkart, for instance, has a lot of very, very interesting opportunities which are available with them. In fact, to the extent of even for a Flipkart, for instance, you can even see whether that is converting to purchase or not. So I don't know whether those options are open right now in the current COVID situation. But definitely those are some things that we will have to explore, because we will get to a situation where we will not even be able to place advertising, forget whether the consumer has even viewed it or not.
Got it. So I will open up the questions. Before that, I'm just asking one more question, which I found was interesting. Agencies today are finding it difficult in terms of how do you stay relevant, because brands are struggling, businesses are struggling, so agency's role automatically has become very insignificant that way. What do you all have any inputs in terms of how agencies can stay relevant to their clients at this point of time? If yes, what are the ways to stay relevant?
So absolutely, actually this is the time where agencies have to be all the more relevant, because I'm sure clients are looking for partners who can help them out. And ideas don't need to come from, ideas can come from anywhere, right? On what can be done to, circumvent the situation. One of the things that agencies do very well is that they really understand consumers. So right now, what you need to do is that you really need to understand your client. And very importantly, you need to understand the consumer. Because if you understand the consumer, you are going to be helping your client in what is it that they need to do to handhold the consumer right now and move forward with them. This is the time for partnership, and of course for whatever campaigns that are happening at this point in time, that is where the support needs to be done. But what I don't think agencies should only think about communication alone. Agencies should think about product itself, right? Because we are thinking out of the box on everything of the product mix, whether it is product, whether it is communication, whether it is distribution, are there some special offers that can be done? What are the kind of initiatives that can be done? So there are so many things that need to be done at this point in time. And at this point in time, if an agency is able to partner the client, the bond which will get created is going to be far stronger than what you could have created earlier.
So the idea is to go beyond advertising or design or anything like that and get into real innovation and solutioning them.
In the conventional sense.
Yes.
Yeah, like it's always said, the advertising agency is like an extension of the marketing department of the client. Okay. Some people take it really seriously and do it that way. Some people do it professionally, but whatever. I think it's all the more relevant that they need to play a big part right now, not just in communication, but also in terms of strategy, in terms of listening. They handle multiple brands, multiple clients. So the learning for an ad agency, media agency is far, far greater than just the marketing department of a particular client. That learning, I think, should come in overall from what the market is saying. Second most important thing is they shouldn't be doing lazy advertising. What I mean by lazy advertising is don't repeat ad copy from before. Show that you're awake, you're listening in the current scenario, and adapt and adopt communication that is relevant now with sympathy, with relevance, with a changing scenario. And that is not an easy job, because you have to be very careful in what you're saying. You have to be very careful in what you should not be saying, right? And if this period is going to make the client innovate into different areas, launch new brands, new extensions, which means you need to be very nimble-footed in trying to get out that strategy out, get that communication out. So I think it's extremely important to have an agency, not just as a partner, but also as a friend. That's my view.
Awesome. So we'll get into questions directly. Ajay, do you want to shoot your question, Ajay? You can unmute and I've unmuted you. You can ask now.
Yeah. Hello. My question is to Sanchi. Hi, Sanchi.
Hi, Ajay. Hi. Good to see you.
Hi. Yeah, good to see you too. Sanchi, my question to you is, we always talk about, the spirit of partnership. We talk about, consolidating partnerships and actually really trying to be in the client's shoes. Do you think this particular time of the lockdown period is a great opportunity for, basically from the media owner's perspective, to really strengthen and broaden? You basically talked about how from an agency perspective, we need to get into the product. But from a media owner perspective, and being from the Times Group, I can basically ask you as to how important it is that the clients will actually look at this particular period. And also maybe the value that, a media owner can actually derive out of this particular strength could be far more valuable as compared to the normal times. And they would rather want to basically be with a player who has multiple media assets as compared to, probably spraying it all around. So do you think the emotional connect and the inherent emotional connect value that will actually infer would be far greater as compared to normal times?
Absolutely, Ajay. See, let me put it like this. The agency, it's a triumvirate that works, right? It is the agency, it is the client, it is the media partner who is so, so critical, because, that's where the magic happens. So, without the media partner, there is nothing that we can really do. So, actually, media partners coming up with ideas which we can collectively work towards and then take across to our client is absolutely something that we should be doing right now. So, for instance, we know in usual times also, the distribution might that newspapers have is something that we've already always spoken about, right? So at this particular time where there is a challenge of distribution, is there something that the newspaper partners can provide? Along with that, the Times Group, for instance, has a whole set of various things, right? You have a completely multimedia bouquet that can be offered. So what really happens is that if there is a big idea, if there is a great, it may not even be a big idea, but if it's a great idea, right? That great idea needs to be given a face. It needs to be given hands and legs. That is where the media partner can help. And if it is consolidated and then, built upon, then you're able to take something really meaty and meaningful across to the consumer. And that absolutely is the need of the hour.
Right. Thank you. Thank you so much, Sanchi. Thank you.
Thanks, Ajay. Thanks.
Any other questions from anybody? There is one in the chat window which says, being in traditional manufacturing, being a traditional manufacturing company, what are your thoughts which we should be adopting? Any tips from a branding marketing perspective? to stay relevant. They are specifically in the plastic tanks, pipes, waste bins kind of an industry. So their point of view saying that, okay, what perspective which they want is typically saying that, okay, what is the advice for us being in the manufacturing sector?
Right.
The Wildcraft example is a great example of innovation, but is there any more other inputs what you can give to manufacturing in specific?
Right. So I'm going to be talking about a few trends, you know, that we are seeing that are going to be there to stay. So one is this whole thing of health mindedness. So people have really, really. So I don't know from the plastics perspective, is there? So there are a few consumer thoughts and trends that can be taken into account. So one is this whole thing of health mindedness. The other thing is this whole thing of respect for nature and environment. This, you know, this we know that this everybody has become very aware that this current situation has also happened because we did not take the climate crisis into account. We've been reading news about it, we've been seeing things about it, but we just don't want to acknowledge it. And the reality is that because we have been, humans have been encroaching on wildlife territories. From wildlife, there are viruses which are moving, and we are seeing each of these coming up again and again. So somewhere this wake-up call has come that, you know, you cannot just sit aside and not think about the climate crisis anymore. So this whole, and I'm sure all of y'all, when you're seeing all your WhatsApp messages and the general sentiment which is there, that there is this whole respect for nature and environment. So I'm just thinking a little aloud right now, but from the plastic, because you talked plastic, now, do they have products which are, you know, which are biodegradable? Are they products which, you know, take care of the environment? Because a lot of people will really want to pick up products which are not harming the environment. The other thing that is going to happen is carbon miles, which people are talking about, right? So carbon miles, which are created by, obviously, you know, you have, When you're transporting things from a long distance, if it is coming by air, then there is a carbon mile that gets attached to it, right? Because that much of fuel is being burnt, etc., etc. Local products, for instance, will have lower carbon miles, so therefore it is environmentally it is better. You know, so these are some of the things that they could kind of think of what is there in their repertoire that they can use. And if their plastic, I don't know what category they are in. So if the plastic is falling into essential category, like household items, et cetera, then of course, you know, they are going to be, they are at grocers, for instance. Now they need to tell people that they are at grocers. You know, we are there. If you want us, we are there. I don't know what exact category, but for instance, if it is into building products and all of that, then that's a different thing. Like you are on mute.
Sundar, any point of view on that?
Yes, I do have. For example, I don't know if it's the person or the industry talking about is B2B or B2C. If it is B2C, there is no immediate need for plastic or any of that thing right now. So I would say please have some patience. Or if you can repurpose into doing something else, so be it, be innovative. But if you're in the B2B category, and keep a close eye on what India imports and what India exports. Because I think that's going to take quite some time to become normal. I don't think any country is going to open up imports and exports unless it's essential things like medicines, food and stuff like that. Because A, they can't manufacture. B, risk of infection and stuff like that. So if you fall under a category where India needs export, then you can replace that and take over that market very quickly using this time, right? So, but I don't know which industry they are in and who they cater to. So I can't give a specific answer, but broadly, I would say directionally, this is the way to go about.
Hi, this is Priyam. I'm from the plastics industry. If I can just pitch in more specifically.
Go for it.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah. So we're actually into the manufacturing of plastic water storage tanks, PVC pipes, dustbins and crates. And for us, it's B2C. It's not B2B. And also, it's not exports to outside India. So we manufacture here in West Bengal. And our consumers are mostly in the eastern region of India. So it's all West Bengal and around the region, in the eastern region. So it is household products because it's household water storage tanks and waste bins, which for domestic, industrial, commercial, all sorts of uses. So I was just wondering, how to appear as a brand that cares, and at the same time, it's not single-use plastic. I mean, to clarify the climate and environment-friendly point, it is also biodegradable. So, what's the best way to advertise, and where and how?
So I think you'll have to break it. Thanks, Priyam. You'll have to break it into two parts. So your portfolio is the something which can be purchased right now. Frankly, as Sundar said, right, see, people are only buying essentials. So if I have a dustbin right now, I'm not really going to go and buy another dustbin at this point in time, unless, I have a need. So for instance, there are some societies, there are some societies where, the housekeeping staff are not coming on a regular basis. So maybe, they need to, store more during that time. So these are some of the nuances that you can look at. But whatever is industrial, there will be no requirement at this point in time, because like Sundar said, there is no construction, etc. happening. The fact that it is biodegradable is something that should be really, really talked about, because that is something which is a crying need for right now. So that being built into your story, including creating awareness for the fact, even in general populace, people who do not know that, what needs to be done, that's something that you all could look at.
Sundar, anything more to add on to that?
Absolutely. You may not be able to do something right now, but one good thing.
Not able to hear you. I don't know whether it's only me. Not audible.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay. Not immediate requirement for stuff that you sell, but I think everybody is moving towards being clean. Cleanliness is very, very important. If you go by what's happening, mask, wash your hands often, keep your surroundings clean. The local corporate body is doing, neighborhood cleaning and stuff. So basically being clean, being hygienic is a space that everybody is agreeing to, overemphasized. Nothing wrong in overdoing it. Maybe you want to do some stuff in that area, maybe in the markets in which you operate, just to give a message that, I stand here for cleanliness, I stand here for removing wastage. That is a good space to be in.
Okay. Pragnya, you want to ask the next question? And that would be the last question, unless anybody else has anything.
Thanks, and very interesting discussion today. So I'm Pragnya. My family has a jewelry brand, and we have a jewelry store. We're a small brand. So one of the things that came up in today's discussion is that people are going to move their spend on more essential items and not on luxury products, and especially something like jewelry, which and also we see that there might be a slowdown also in marriages and functions. So what can a brand product jewelry do to stay relevant and just keep alive?
So relevance for jewelry.
Yeah, I can. So of course, I'm sure Sundar will have something very interesting to add. I think this is the. This could be a time where you want to, you have to be careful, because this whole thing of slowdown and actually marriages not happening, a lot of marriages getting cancelled, that is a reality. So you may have to definitely not advertise at this point in time, because it is going to be wasted money. But you need to think about how going ahead, when things become a little, it's not as though people aren't. See, I think the most important thing that we need to take view of is that this is a temporary situation, right? There is light at the end of the tunnel. And when that light comes, at that point in time, we should be prepared. So this could be a time where, you know, maybe there are a lot of loyal customers that you have, where you may want to do one-on-one communication with them and build relationships with them, you know. But conserve your money so that when things get to normal, you are able to utilize those investments to advertise at that point in time. That is the advice that I would give at this point in time.
Okay, may I?
Yes,
yeah.
Yes, go ahead.
I'm just saying, so let's look at jewelry and let's look at one or two categories as well to illustrate a point that I want to make. For example, let's look at watches, luxury watches. Let's look at luxury cars. Let's take these three. There are more, but let's just take these three. Is there a need for it right now? No, there's no need for it right now. However, jewelry purchase, if you look at it, is based on A, some people look at it as investment. Some people look at it as occasion-based buying, which is marriages, birthdays, anniversaries, and so on and so forth. The third category of people purely buy it on a monthly stuff that they buy and buy gold coins and keep it for, maybe a future use, daughter's marriage, and so on and so forth. Now, gold has got a direct relationship with the stock market.
Yes.
Worldwide.
Yes.
Okay. Because when people lose money in one, the other one automatically goes up. And this relationship you can see for the last 40, 50 years. There's data available for you to track this. So normally, the normal wisdom says that the stock market goes down and people need to find alternate ways of looking at where will I put my money. And it's always been noticed that after every crisis, gold has been a very, very good investment. Okay, that's normal. But you're in the jewelry business. So I don't know whether people who want to buy jewelry as an investment or buy gold coins investment. I don't know. That probably you'll know better. The reason why I took watch and car as another parallel example is to illustrate something else. If you look at it, a car is probably, you don't need to have it, but it's nice to have. But value depreciates, right? A luxury watch, in some cases, value depreciates, some it doesn't. But gold never depreciates. So I think you should very carefully watch alternate source of investment, and that would really tell you where to go. Yeah, but in the immediate time, I would say it may not get returns by putting out ads.
I think the one thing that you will have to wait is for distribution. As in, like, once the outlets open, that is when you should be doing your communication. The other thing that Sundar's point is extremely, extremely important, because we know that gold is actually going to all-time highs in terms of price, right? I think it hit 46,000 on one particular day. So if there is an investment, is there an alternate, again, coming back to the distribution and moving online. So is there a way that you can provide people to invest in jewelry right now? Is there an alternate distribution form that you can create instead of going to your store? Can they get online and purchase from you? So these are, again, thinking out of the box on this front, if you want to look at sales at within this interim period. And so typically when you're selling jewelry, you would sell it to the woman. This is the time where it comes to targeting, right? Target audience that you're looking at. Typically you would be selling it to the woman. But in this particular case, you're actually trying to get to the sensibilities of the man, right? You could take it a little step further and say that, you know, today, right now, there are a lot of these articles which are coming out, which are saying that the people who have been affected the most by the lockdown are the women, because they are having to do a lot of the housework, depending on what kind of homes they are in, you know, how much are there the rest of the family helping them out. And they're saying the gender insensitivity of India is really coming out at this point in time. Now, for instance, let's say if you want to say that some men are feeling really bad because their wives are really working very hard. So can you take this into and work out a guilt trip and ask them to buy some jewelry for their wife, you know?
Interesting point of view. So
I think we should put Sanchu on mute now. Quickly put her on mute.
Correct. I'm jumping
this
in.
This is for all the women.
I don't want to encourage that, you know. So anyways, I think we've gone way past our time. We said 1 hour and we have jumped more than 1 hour. So thank you so much, Sanchi and Sundar. It was a pleasure having you on board Never Too Small to Brand, Brandversation. And we will continue to do this every Tuesdays and Fridays. Please follow our social media pages on Instagram as well as Facebook to get to know what the when the next episode is and who's going to be there. So thank you so much, everybody. Thank you, Sundar. Thank you, Sanchi. It was a pleasure having you here. Thank you,
Ravi. Thank you. Thanks, Lai. Thank you.
Absolutely. My pleasure, too. Really enjoyed it.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Thank you. See you all. Bye.